It's not often that my Scotland history tours take you to a location in England, and yet today, that's what I've done. Have I gone rogue? Gone over to the dark side? Gone completely Fruit Loop Heed for Mince mental? Or is it that I'm making a series of videos looking at the different peoples and kingdoms who made Scotland, from the Scots to the Britons, the Picts, the Vikings, and today, I've come to Bamburgh Castle to talk about the Angles. If you're interested in the people, places and events in Scottish history, then click the subscribe button at the bottom right hand side of the screen. In the meantime, let me tell you a story. People often say to me, Bruce, you know a lot about Scottish history. What do you think about independence? And I say, if the English want independence, they can have it. They can even have Wales. But we're keeping Northern Ireland. How else are we going to fill Parkhead and Ibrox every Saturday? That's not going to happen by accident. Our story today starts as the Britons were losing independence. Bamburgh Castle is on the site of what was originally a Britonic fort around the time that the Romans left. Now, saying the Romans left doesn't quite describe the times. The collapse of Roman Britain was chaos like nothing most of us have experienced. Imagine partition in India, when the British wash their hands and leave you after centuries of control. There's breakdown into factions, fear in a place that had been home, people desperately fleeing in a quest for safety, economic breakdown, losing your livelihood to save your life. Or think of post-war Europe with refugees on the move trying to find a place of safety. Think of the Wild West, where law and order was based on whoever was the strongest, most violent, best armed, or fastest on the draw. Now, I'm sure I'm going to get criticism in the comments, and of course, none of these analogies are perfect. I get that. I'm just trying to point out that when the hegemony of centuries-old imperial order disappears and civic structure, social structure, rule of law and currency goes with it, as the Picts and the Scots are clambering over the wall, zombie apocalypse feels a wee bit more than a video game, doesn't it? But wouldn't it be brilliant if the zombies all wore CU Jimmy hats? I think I've just invented a video game. Of course, some take advantage of the disorder to set up as rulers in their own little fiefdoms now that the Romans have gone. Obviously, this didn't all happen on a Tuesday afternoon in October. There had been times past when Britannia had declared independence from Rome. The Picts and the Scots, they'd raided before. The legions had left for mainland Europe to deal with threats to the empire before. But this time, after a while, you realise they're not coming back. It was probably before that point that you started inviting barbarians from across the North Sea to come and protect you from the barbarians coming over Hadrian's Wall. You see, sailing barbarians are fine. It's your wall-climbing barbarians that you have to watch out for. When you thought the legions were coming back, they seemed like a stopgap. When the legions returned, you'd thank the barbarians, you'd maybe have a get-together in the canteen, give out commemorative tankards and wish them all well in whatever rapey, pillagey, mercenary endeavours that they'd planned for the future. Oh, we must keep in touch. Are you on Facebook? Oh, give me your details. But then you realise the legions aren't coming back. The Angles are the new power in the area. This is becoming Angleland. There were effectively two Anglian kingdoms in the north. Deira, that reached from the Humber to the Tees, and Bernicia, that stretched further north. Now, amidst all that goes on over the next few centuries, the kings of these two kingdoms will fight against each other, winning and losing. Sometimes the Bernician king will control Deira, sometimes the Deiran king, Bernicia. Sometimes the two will coexist, and sometimes they'll come together as a single entity. History tells us that United Kingdoms aren't eternal. They're subject to the vagaries of identity, fortune, and circumstance. And the warlords in both these little kingdoms will have each other and neighbours to deal with. Just as within what will become England, territories changed over time, so within what would become Scotland. In the series on the peoples who made Scotland, I've tried to weigh a bit of an anchor in the late 6th, early 7th century. In my video about the Scots, I mention Aidan McGabran. The Britons of Alt Clute, I refer to Rivercahill. In case anyone's actually following these videos, these two kings coincided with and conflicted with the Angle King of Bernicia, Aethelfrith. Now, the Britons had been fighting a losing Arthurian battle against the rising Anglian power for a while. They tried to regain control by besieging the island of Lindisfarne behind us, but the Angles defeated them. When the Britons made one last gasp attempt to reclaim territory at what's now called Catterick, the Angles defeated them. In my video about the Scots of Dalriada, I explained how Aidan McGabran then led a force to deal with Aethelfrith at Degiston. What I didn't mention was that his army would also have contained the remnants of the Britons and indeed an Anglian competitor to Aethelfrith for the throne of Bernicia. Aethelfrith defeated them. From his power base here at Bamburgh, this Bernician ruler was unchallenged. He then unified the two Anglian kingdoms of Bernicia and Deira and married the daughter of the previous king of Deira. Now, I'm not entirely sure in which order that happened. Did she jump or was she pushed? And why did her daddy the king die around the same time? The point is that their sons would have the right to rule both those united kingdoms. But 13 years later, in 617 AD, it was her brother, the son of the dead King Adira, who killed Aethelfrith in battle. Aethelfrith's sons, approaching their teens by this stage, fled with her mother to live amongst the Scots of Dalriada. In Dalriada, they grew to maturity. At the fortress of Danad, they were hosted by the son of Aidan McGabran. It was with the monks of Iona that they were educated. So when Aethelfrith's son Oswald came back from Dalriada to retake his throne 17 years later, he brought Christianity to the pagan land of the Angles and he established the abbey here at Lindisfarne. I've actually got another video that gives some more detail on that. But not only did Oswald take control here in Bernicia and in Deira, but like his dad before him, he started making inroads into the territory of the Britons further north as well, besieging Edinburgh in 638 AD. In Max Adams' book, The King in the North, link in the description, he says of Oswald, he was a famed warrior, the first English king to die a Christian martyr, the embodiment of a romantic hero, the righteous exiled prince whose destiny is to return triumphant to reclaim his throne. More than that, he's almost the first Englishman of whom a biography might be written. His political legacy was partly responsible for the Crusades and for the idea that Britain is a Christian state. He was the model for Tolkien's Aragorn in The Lord of the Rings. If popular history needs an heroic figure from the age of Beowulf, there's no need to invent or reinvent one. Oswald was the real thing. Of course he is. He was brought up Scottish. Like each of the peoples who made Scotland, the power of the Angles ebbed and flowed over the years, and the different royal houses gained and lost. In 685, a key battle with the Picts brought a disaster that I'll have to wait for another day because an even bigger disaster was waiting. You often see tours from Edinburgh to here in Bamburgh Castle advertised as the Viking Coast. You see, in 793, shockwaves were sent through the English people when Vikings attacked and plundered Lindisfarne here. The Scots at Dalriada faced the same thing with an attack in Iona 2 years later. The time of the Vikings had come. Over the next 50 years or so, Viking attacks brought Picts and Scots together further north.
And then down here, when the great Viking army arrived, that southern part of Northumbria that we call Deira became the Viking Kingdom of York. Here in Bernicia, the Viking takeover wasn't quite so complete, but everyone knew who was boss. Now, the fact that the Vikings episode's still to come, and yet they're involved in this one, shows how messy the whole business of Scotland's formation was, and how ridiculous it is for people to talk about Scottish ethnicity. I'll be honest, I'm not even sure how many of the people who talk like that are even Scottish. My point is that over a 500-year period, the territory and ethnicity of Northumbrians, the people north of the Humber, had been changing. Angles replaced Britons, Vikings replaced Angles, and of course, they would intermingle and they would have a bit of, how's your father? You know what those Vikings are like. The Picts and the Scots had also been consolidating. So when, I tell you what, let me take you to one last place. This is Carrum. It feels like a quintessentially quaint little English village, and it is, but only just. You see, this is the River Tweed. The north side of that is Scotland. This is somewhere else entirely. If you watch my video about the quirks of the Scotland-England border, the village of Wark that I mentioned is less than 2 miles in that direction. But in 1018, this River Tweed wasn't a border. This side of the river was Northumbria that we've been talking about, but so was the north side. Now, there are some sources that suggest that Scots control had been creeping further south. But whether or not that was the case, 1018 seems just about as definitive as snatched sentences from possibly erroneous copies of conflicting ancient annals with contradictory sources can be. Two armies met here at Carrum. Malcolm II of Scotland came south, accompanied by Owen the Bald, the king of the Strathclyde Britons that we've mentioned in another episode. The other Anglo-Danish Northumbrian army, they came north under Uhtred of Bamburgh. If there had been any doubt before, there was no doubt by the end of the battle. Everything north of the river was Scottish. The people north of the River Tweed had been Britons, then Angles of Bernicia, and then a kind of Anglian-Vikingy mix. From now on, they'd be Scottish borderers. If you want to hear more about the different peoples who made Scotland, then there'll be a link to another video coming up now on screen. In the meantime, I mean, Doc is going to be a lamb alive. Cheery and drasta.